Good evening. Welcome to House Baptist Church. Let's stand and worship together.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing now? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb?
thankful that when we were prone to wander that the Lord pursued after us. Amen. I don't know if you saw this last week. There was a kind of a comical but realistic video circulating around on social media. It was a sheep, a lamb that got caught down in a ditch line, you know, and the shepherd reached down, finally tugged that sheep out, and that sheep came flying out of there and took off like they always do, went running and jumped and landed right back in the hole all over again, you know, and thought about wandering Sheila, you know. That's what I was really thinking about tonight. But good to see you out here this evening. Had a great day in the Lord's house, and just thanking the Lord for what he's done here this last week. Throughout the children's ministry, both in the service and right afterwards, there were four kids saved over last week, and then we had a teenager saved in the Bible studies on Wednesday. Then this morning we had a Walter Schossel. He's running around here somewhere. I can't see everybody. Where's he at? There he is, right here. I'm sorry. I'm looking over here, and he's on. He's over here. Walter Schossel, late service, walked the aisle and got saved this morning. So let's give the Lord a hand. Amen for those decisions. So. Amen. Amen. So just thanking the Lord for what he's doing and looking forward to what God's going to do tonight. We'll be in 1 Peter 5 here in just a moment, but let's continue to worship the Lord. In the meantime, if you're visiting, make sure you get a coffee mug and a connection card as a gift for you. Fill out the connection card if you'd be so kind. Let's continue to worship the Lord tonight.
Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I have always known, a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. Oh, 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 forever echo, holy is the Lord. Memorized by every heart, written in eternity. Every lifted voice apart, joining in the symphony. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. Oh, all wisdom and wonder belong to no other but you. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of standing at the end of time, there before the throne of grace, majesty before my eyes, I'll let it take my breath away. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven. holy is the Lord.
And if you remain standing tonight, 1 Peter 5, in verse number 5, we have started a series a number of months back. Next, this is the final sermon, Lord willing. We're going to be here till 9:30 tonight. And so, to my records, this is the 34th sermon in 1 Peter. And so, why would it take you that long? There's only five chapters, you know. Well, there's a lot of good stuff in there, amen. And maybe a normal person could get through it in a lot shorter time. Maybe others would take a lot longer time, amen. But here we are. We come to 1 Peter 5, verse number 5. And the desire in this series of Just, of course, to go verse by verse and study out God's Word and let it feed us, feed our souls, and it's how we grow. We read it and explain it and understand it and apply it to our lives. That's how we grow thereby. And we see that we live in days and times where Christ and His Word and the truths of Scripture are continually being opposed. Amen. We see that on all fronts, and so we need to be ready both now and for the future for what will come certainly. And so we see that Peter admonishes us well to prepare. 1 Peter 5, verse number 5, we'll read down to verse 14. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder, yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. While Silvanus or Silas, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein you stand. The church that is at Babylon, elected together with you, saluteth you, and so doth Marcus, my son. Greet you one another with a kiss of charity. Peace be with you all that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's pray tonight. Dearly Father, we count ourselves blessed that we have a copy of your word that we can open. Lord, to be able to come on a Sunday night, and it's a beautiful evening outside, and there's a countless other things that these folks could be doing, but Lord, they've come to lift their voice up to you, to gather together with the brethren, to open your word, to learn of it. And Lord, for anyone here tonight that needs to be saved, may this be the night they come. For each and every one of us, Lord, that are here as believers, may we just be admonished and encouraged from your word. We thank you for the songs of worship you've already been a part of. Bless, Lord, this gathering, this assembly. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated tonight. You know, I really wanted to just hit this. I felt a timely series. So we think about faith in the fire, and we don't know what the future is going to hold. We know in the tribulation time, of course, after the rapture, that things will get more challenging. And I believe as it gets closer to the end of time, that the fire is only going to turn up, right? The intensity is only going to be more and more. And I think for us and for present and future generations of Christians, it does us well to take the admonition to heart, just as Peter and his believers in that early century, that early church period, were facing hardships under the government, were facing hardships by Nero and others, those around them. So we must expect to endure the same thing. And as time passes, we can already sense these things coming. And it seems to be that at certain seasons they come more rapidly. Would you agree with that? And we seem to find that coming upon us now. And so just as Peter admonished his day to say, look, you're facing the furnace, it's going to get hotter. And how do you prepare for that? And so throughout this series, this is again the 34th sermon in this series, the faith in the fire. But as we've been finding out that a true faith will not fade away. It will persevere. It will endure unto the end. And we will come forth refined. And so I believe that. And I think what we need to do then is to take these truths that Peter gives us, take them deep into our hearts. And I think really what does us well is for us and for the younger generation to do all that we can to ground them in the Word, to know what they believe, to know why they believe it, to be able to stand and give a defense, amen, to give a defense of their faith, that it isn't just the faith of their fathers, but it's their faith, amen, that they know the Lord personally, they can articulate that correctly. And so that's why we just, you know, continually take you through the Word of God, that you can read it as you do and seek to understand it as you do and be able to apply it in the life and the world in which we live. Because regardless of what the world does out there, it doesn't change what we're called to do in here. It doesn't change what we're called to take out into the world. We're called to be lights in the darkness. And so no matter how dark the world gets, we're always called to be light. And so we must prepare for that. So we come to this last section of 1 Peter and chapter 5. We started this morning to look at essentials to be a ready servant. Essentials to be a ready servant. How do we prepare? We need to prepare in the same way that a soldier would. The same way that an athlete would, the same way that a farmer would. They just put a lot of time and diligence and work in for a future date, for a future time, a future challenge. And so we looked at a few principles this morning. The first thing we said out of verse 5 is submission. These are the basics that Peter takes us back to. It's almost like he gives this long sermon, and then he comes back and says, okay, now remember these things. And he says, submit. Submit yourself to what? To the elders, the leaders in the church. Submit yourself, verse 5, to one another. The second thing he said in verse 5 and 6, he says, be clothed with humility. Put on an apron, right? Just as Jesus did. And he bowed down and he served his disciples. He washed their feet, right? Take off your garb and put on a servile robe and attach that to yourself. And to do so with humility. What is humility? We said, humble is low to the ground. To have a little view of yourself. And that is so different from what the world admonishes. So if we're going to be a ready servant for, as 1 Peter 4:12 says, the fiery trial that will come, then we need to be submissive. We secondly need to be humble. Third, we need to learn to wait. This doesn't mean idleness. This doesn't mean laziness. But this means waiting with the sense that we're trusting the Lord. And trusting the Lord in His timing, right? In His good timing. Verse number 6 says that He may exalt you in due time. What is due time? It is God's time. Can I say to you, most oftentimes, God's time and my time are not on the same page, are they, you know? I'm always like, way up here, Lord, come on, you know? Unless God wants me to do something for Him, then I'm like way back here, you know? I always think back to this, and when God was dealing in my heart about ministry, and, you know, it's one thing to be in ministry, to surrender to ministry, but then it's another to get up in front of people and speak. You know, it's like, boy, it sounds good. I'm going to be a preacher one day. You know, one day is in like decades way off, you know. And then I never forget what my boss that I was shared with, he was our college and career teacher. And he said, hey, we're having a bonfire coming up this end of this month. And he said, I need someone to share a devotion at that bonfire. And I was thinking about you. And I'm like, you know, yeah, I'm called to ministry, but that's like way down the road, you know, and I ain't time soon. And man, was I nervous. First message I ever gave, and I got up there, man, I was shaking, you know, I was nervous. I was all worked up in the lather. What am I going to talk about and everything else? I was so scared. I was so fearful and fretful. But you know what? The Lord used that, and that night we had two people get saved. And I just give God the glory for that. And so it's not a matter of doing things on your time that He would exalt you in His good time. God is never early. God is never late. He's always right on time. And we must rest in that. And fourth, tonight we see in verse number 7, we need to trust. We need to trust Him. And this comes to verse number 7. It says, casting all your care upon Him, for He careth for you. Someone said it years back. I thought it was very insightful. If you're casting, you're lasting. If you're casting, you're lasting. Think about this. If you go through life and you only carry the burdens and you never unload those burdens, that is a weight that is going to be heavier than you are ever intended to bear. Parker Daly, the late preacher, said it well. He said, carry the blessings, not the burdens. Carry the blessings and not the burdens. You know, as you serve the Lord and you walk through this dark world filled with defeated people and sin abounds on every corner, you know, it's as though we go through life and we put these weights in our bag, you know, and maybe they start out small, but then you begin to accumulate them, and then the ones that are there begin to grow, and over time this becomes a heavy weight to us, and what we once were doing, we were advancing in the cause of Christ. Now the cares of this world begin to weigh us down, and it overwhelms us to the place where we're no longer advancing in Christ. We're stationary. We're just kind of parked out, you know. Our transmission's done hit the floor, right? We aren't going anywhere. You know, it's like we go through this world, and it's like walking through a field of briars, you know. You come out on the other side, and you got those thickly prickly pears all over you, you know. You got those sticker bushes all over you, and definitely feel that weight. And so sometimes we go through life and we carry these weights and we carry these burdens, and it's a filthy world to live in, right? And it's affecting our eyes and our mind and our hearts and our lives. And I think we think about the weight of the trials and the hardships that Peter's day was facing. And we may feel sometimes as the disciples felt in the boat. Remember what Mark 4:38, when they're in the boat and the storm's going on and Jesus is asleep in the bottom of the boat, you know. And we could assimilate with them, and Jesus is there, he's asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and saying to him, you know, we read it like, "Master, carest thou not that we perish." It's probably more like, "Master, carest thou not that we perish." You know, I'm sure they weren't very subdued. They weren't like the Methodists, you know. I mean, they're probably more like the Pentecostals there, you know. And they were all worked up to a lather, I can only imagine. Sometimes we may feel like that. "Lord, don't you know what we're going through right now? We are going to surely perish." And sometimes we ask ourselves, does God care, and does he see, and is he aloof to our pain and our feeling? Let's remind ourselves of some great truths tonight. Verse 7 says, "Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you." Can I say to you, there are many examples in the scriptures of people who cast their burden on the Lord. Remember back in 1 Samuel 1, verse 10 to 18, Hannah was barren, and in that day and time, to be barren was looked down upon, was scorned, and they would have felt bereaved of the Lord, and that somehow the Lord had judged them. And so she was deeply grieved. To add insult to injury, her husband had two wives. Peninnah was the other wife, and here Hannah is barren, and Peninnah, the other wife, was able to just, you know, have child after child. But then old Elkanah, you know, he was real like most men are. He had a way with words. He said to her one day, he said, "Am I not better to you than all these children?" Obviously, he wasn't, because she was still praying for a child. You know what I'm saying? Man, let's not go there, okay? Okay, you know, you obviously aren't, because she's still praying for a child. No, he was very good and gracious too. I'm not trying to make light of that. But you read in 1 Samuel 1, and she comes to the house of the Lord, and she's grieved in spirit. And what does she do? The Bible says that she poured out her soul in the Lord, and Eli the priest even thought she was drunk in the manner in which she was acting. And she said, "Oh, no, don't count me to be a daughter of Belial." She said, I have poured out my soul to the Lord. You know what? Eli, you know, said, "The Lord has heard you." And she got up, and she rose, and she went on her way. You know, there was a sense there where she gave it to the Lord, and she left it there. She didn't keep carrying it with her, did she? She didn't walk in, you know, carrying bag like Santa Claus, you know, and then walk back out the same way, you know. She came and she gave it to the Lord, and she went on her way. And she trusted. She'd cast her care upon the Lord, and in due time God gave her, "He hath heard," which meant Samuel. We find it again and again throughout. We see that David, when he was at a place of discouragement and all the men spoke of stoning him, when their families had been taken in a ransacking of their city, David says he encouraged himself in the Lord. We're reminded in Psalm 55:22, "Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved." Remember in Matthew 6:26, and we sing this as a hymn, "Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they?" Again, remember, often the scriptures would teach from the least to the greatest, or from the greatest to the least. If the Lord would take care of the sparrow of the field, and they say by some estimates there may be between 200 and 400 billion sparrows, and there's only 7 billion of us. If God cares for the 200 to 400 billion sparrows and looks after their needs, what care do you have that he's not going to look after? You ask yourself, well, can I cast my burden on him? You know, isn't he a busy God? He's got like 7 billion other whiny people that are praying to him all the time. He surely don't have time for little old me. Are we able to give everything unto him? What burden? Should we give him just some, the real big ones, you know? No, it's not like that at all. Is there any hope? Listen, we need to remind ourselves, John 10:11, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd," right? "The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep." You know, Jesus is not a hireling. He's not a hired hand punching a clock, is he? He cares. He genuinely and sincerely cares for the sheep. He doesn't flee when hardship comes. Why should you cast all your care upon him? Because verse 7 says he cares for you. When you think about whatever you may face in life, whether it's at school or work or home, and you feel to be the only one that's striving and seeking to serve the Lord, and we don't know what days may come. Oh, dear friend, days could get very dark. And we were watching a video the other night about Corrie Ten Boom and her faith and her family's faith, and just to kind of watch that and see how people in the not too recent past face such incredible hostilities, and many of her family members, of course, died at the hands of the Nazis and in concentration camps, and how they were even faithful in the midst of those times. Oh, dear friend, we don't know what the future holds for us, but no matter what it holds, let us never forget we can cast all care upon him, because if he cares for the sparrow, he cares for you. And the passage that always hits me hard is Romans 8, 31 and 32. When you think about God's care for you, remember Romans 8, 31 and 32. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us, right? If God's in your corner, it matters not who is against you. But I would say if God's not in your corner, it matters not who is in your corner. Verse 32 says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him Christ also freely give us all things? Remember this, dear friend, that if God the Father gave us the greatest and the gift of his Son, would he not also give you every lesser thing? What's the greatest thing he could have given you? His Son. He paid the ultimate price. And if the ultimate debt, like the national debt of the United States of America, we had that many sins against us, and God came and said, through the gift of my Son and the sacrifice that he made, I'm going to plop down and I'm going to pay for all of your sins of all sinners of all time. And if God would pay that debt, what lesser debt in your life and mine would he not pay? And if that kind of God cares for me, that he would give the greatest, what little things do I face in life that I could also trust him with? Cast on the Lord. Why? Because he cares for us. He cares. He knows our anxieties. He knows when we are pulled apart and we need to give it unto the Lord. Cast it all on the Lord. Leave it with the Lord. Give it to him and stop picking it up, right? We say, well, I'll give God the big ones, but I'll keep the little ones. Well, sooner or later, the little ones become the big ones, don't they? And so we must not find that we are giving portions to him. God cared for those. God cares for us. Peter knew this care. In the gospel accounts, you read about Jesus healing Peter's mother-in-law. He must have had a good mother-in-law, right? Giving him a great catch of fish and helping him pay the temple tax and helping him walk on water and repairing the damage he did to the ear of Malchus and even delivering Peter from prison. Listen, the Lord cared for Peter. Peter knew that. But we also know that the cares of this life are ministries and opportunities and part of life. We must cast on the Lord, leave with him that which we can, but also not ignore what he wants us to do in each situation. You know, sometimes there are situations that, yes, we want to give the Lord, but we must not be ignorant or not discerning to the opportunities that he lays at our feet. Cast thy burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He gives us courage to face our cares honestly and not run away. You know, we're like that little sheep that likes to run away, right? Jump back in the ditch line, you know? Yet Isaiah 41:10 says, fear not, right? Fear thou not, for why? I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. I was thinking about being a little kid, you know? A lot of times I was fearful. When you had 4-inch biceps, you were fearful, even little sisters if I had them, you know? Which Jared was like a little sister, but he deserved it. Last Monday staff meeting, he's like, I can't wait, you know, till Pastor McInerney comes and you get a little dose of your medicine, you know. Going to find out, I guess Jared was the one getting a little dose of his medicine, so. Just a little side note there. Let me pause. Something you might not be privy to. Do you remember what Pastor McInerney said in one of those sermons about his dear, saintly, sweet wife? Yes, we all remember, if you were there that time, and something to the effect of she being hard enough to live with saved, something along those lines. And I said, oh, preacher. He thought I said, oh, preacher. I said, oh, no, oh, preacher, don't. Oh, she's a sweet lady. And you wouldn't want to say that, you know. Well, what pastor doesn't know, you get the blessing of working around Jared, is Jared is also our tech guy. So whatever you say, especially that's recorded, Jared already has it before the service is over. You know, it's like FBI, CIA, and then Jared. He's over top of all of it, you know. So the next morning, we got up and we drove down to Bible Baptist Church, Mount Orb, and he says, oh, he said, have you talked to Teresa yet about what he'd said the night before? It's Tuesday, and he said, no, not yet. He said, and she didn't message anything or anything, and so he said, oh, well, she knows. And he said, well, how does she know? He's like, oh, I took care of that last night. He sent the audio clip to her two sons, Kenton and Caden, to make sure that show this to your mom type thing, you know? So the whole way down there, preacher's like, oh, you didn't, you know? he was like really squirming and hurting, and Jared was stoking the flames. So as the week went on, you notice Jared was kind of getting it back anyway. But I think about growing up many times and being fearful and being afraid. And yet I always think about, you know, if I was a little boy, I could be fearful and afraid. But if my dad was with me, I wasn't scared of anything. And I think about how we can go through this life and we may feel all alone. And we may feel outnumbered. We may feel fearful of the things in this world. And yet the Lord reminds us, fear thou not, why, for I am with thee. He gives us wisdom to understand the situation. He gives us strength to do what we must do. He gives us the faith to trust Him to do the rest. We see we need to trust and cast all of our care, unload those burdens on Him. Fifthly, we need to be vigilant. Be vigilant. Be watchful. Verse 8 and 9. Why? Because we have an enemy, don't we? We have someone who's lurking, someone who's seeking to destroy. Verse 8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Verse 9, and says there, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Be vigilant, be watchful. We know who this lion is, don't we? He's the one that is our adversary. He is Apollyon. He is Abaddon. He is the destroyer. That word in verse number 8 where it says seeking to devour you, that word comes from the same meaning where the Red Sea drowned the Egyptian army. So Satan wants to drown you. Can I say to you, you give Satan a place, you give Satan a foothold, and he will drown you. Dear friend, I can't emphasize this enough. I don't think we understand how much he wants to destroy. He's not trying to destroy unbelievers, you understand? He already has unbelievers, right? They're already in his family. So what's he going to come after? He's going to come after the cream of the crop. He's going to come after you. He's going to come after the children of God. He's going to come after those who have given themselves to the Lord and consecrated themselves to the Lord. And he wants to damage and destroy and devour their testimony. So what must we do? We must know that he is a real adversary. He's not some little cartoon figure that we can toy around with. He's in opposition to God. He's in opposition to the people of God. He's not omnipresent, omniscient, or omnipotent. He's a singular being, but he does have a host of fallen angels, these demons, as we may call them, who were some bound permanently, some bound temporarily, and some are free. When Satan fell, a third of the angels, Revelation 12 says, fell with him. They are his minions in the world, pawns that are doing his bidding. Now, my friend, he opposes all that God stands for. He opposes the true church. He stands against the Great Commission. He stands up against true believers. He doesn't assault and attack unbelievers. As I said, they're already blinded. He goes after the children of God, often seeking out the best among God's people. I believe the greater the influence, the greater the assault. Listen, you're taking a stand at your place of work or your place of home. You're being a witness. Can I say to you, he wants nothing more to mark you off and tear you down. And you got to be ready. You got to realize this is not a joke. It's not a game. And how important it is to be prepared. Think about some of the examples in the scriptures. What do we know? Some of the greatest people that were used by God were the greatest ones who were assaulted by Satan. Think in your mind with me about Job in chapter 1 and 2. Was he not God saying, here's my servant. He's the greatest of all the men in the east. Feared God. Sacrificed on behalf of his family. He knew the Lord, loved the Lord. Have you considered him? And Satan went and he essentially rent everything from him minus one complaining wife that maybe Job would have said you could have taken her too, you know. But Job, Satan went after Job. Peter, we know in Luke 22, did he not come wanting to sift him like wheat? Paul in 2 Corinthians 12 was sent a messenger of Satan to buffet him, and he prayed to God that this thorn, this messenger of Satan would be removed, and God left it there. He attacked the committed believers in the church at Smyrna. They were like the myrrh plant, right? How do we know when that aroma comes out? Well, it was a plant, and when the plant would send forth the aroma, the only way it sent it forth was when it was crushed. They were crushed under the persecution that came about by Satan and his henchmen. Can I just say to you, my friend, Satan marks out the Jobs and the Peters and the Pauls and the early church of Smyrna, and he wants to assault and attack them. He's not worried about those who are not preaching the gospel. He's not worried about those who are serious about taking sin as it is and serious about being a witness for the cause of Christ. He's not worried about watered down versions of that. Oh, but my friend, if you get serious with God, he's going to assault you. So why does God allow Satan to come against his people? Well, we know this. It proves the sincerity of the salvation and perseverance of true believers. You know what it does? It proves to Satan what he was not, faithful. It proves that you can't ruin the true testimony of a real believer. Job had his struggles, but Job finished. Peter had his struggles, but Peter finished. Paul had his struggle, and he says, yeah, I've run the race, finished the course, kept my faith, and there is laid up for me a crown of glory that the Lord will give unto me and all that love his appearing. The church at Smyrna and many other persecuted believers in the early church period may have paid the ultimate price. Peter was about to pay that ultimate price here, and yet we find this. Satan may come and attack and assault, but my friend, if your faith is true and genuine, it will only reveal to Satan what he isn't, and that's faithful. Persevering, enduring. How should we view Satan? We need to realize he's our adversary. He's a slanderer. He is a deceiver. He is a lion. He will come to devour. We need to respect him. Why? Because he's dangerous. Now, we tease Brother Shane a lot about working as an electrician, and he'll tell you his stories. It always begins with one word, Denier. That's the company he used to work for. I'm giving some inside staff jokes here, all right? But back at Denier, you know, then he gives on to this big long, you're like, that's the 37th story you told me that, and maybe 37 times about that one story, but don't tell Brother Shane, you know that, all right? But we don't know something about electricity, and we've always teased because Jared sometimes ends up doing more electricity work than what Shane does, you know, but don't tell Jared that either, you know, and so he's going to get the big head, the swell love. Anyway, they say I never tease Shane, so I got to make it equal sometimes, so you know. So, but you know, they say one thing about electricity you got to realize is you got to respect the electricity, don't you? You got to respect the power that's there. If you don't, you're going to find out sometimes the hard way that it's not too well. Now, think about Satan. Listen, we know he has power, but we want to respect him knowing that he is dangerous. We know that in Zechariah 3, he comes as an accuser, doesn't he? Revelation 12, he comes as the accuser of the brethren. How do we stand up against him? I won't take the time to break all this down, but you could go back and read Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. He assails us with fiery darts, and it gives us the wardrobe, the soldiers, a garb and gear to protect us against him with the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, girt about with the belt of truth, and having upon our feet the shoes shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And we have the sword of the Spirit in our hand. We need to prepare ourselves through all these different means because we know he is a dangerous enemy. Listen, we need to have respect for him. We also need to recognize he's a great pretender. He's called in John 8:44 a father of lies. 2 Corinthians 11 says that he's an angel of light. Wherever God sows true seeds and true crops, Satan comes behind and sows tares, doesn't he? So we got to understand something, and I really, through that Christianity Last Days series we did for a couple of years, that was really part of my concern because I find that so many times today Christians are so willing to live their life at a very minimal level. You know, I've got Jesus, you know, I know a few verses and that's enough. I'm saved on my way to heaven, rah, rah, rah. I believe you need to know what the Word of God says. You can be so easily deceived. Satan is an angel of light. He fills the pulpits of this world. He fills the churches of this world. He convinces many by deception. It's not some major thing that he does, right? It's the small deceptions. And if you don't know the Word, if you're not in the Word, you're more confident than Jesus was. Because when Jesus stood against Satan, he didn't use logic, experience, or history, or time that he walked with the Lord, or walking in the Spirit. He refuted him three times, Scripture, Scripture, Scripture. And unless you think you know more Scripture than Jesus, you need to get in the Word every day, know the Word, so you can discern the error that he brings your way. How will he come? He will lure you through the lust of your eyes, the lust of your flesh, the pride of your life. How will he lure you? He'll use that which causes you to befriend the world, that which denies God's word, that which feeds the flesh, that which will cause you to break your honorable commitments, anything that will violate God's word and God's will, undermining your commitments to Christ, his church, and your covenants. These things may not appear to be bad and evil things, but appear as angels, quote, of good things. But it is in the expediencies of the good that he brings you down to the evil. Listen, my friend, just be on guard about these things. So many times I've watched over the years as people are excited about a new promotion or a new job. And I'm not saying that these things won't ever come and God isn't in those things. But just a concern when a new job takes you away and you can't even come to church. I just got to stop sometimes and ask myself, is the Lord really in that? When you can't even come to church, did God give you that or did Satan work that out? The new opportunity that's going to stretch your margins. And man, this new opportunity came up and man, I'm going to be busy almost every night of the week. And well, maybe I'll make it to church every so often, but my margin is stretched so thin. I'm so exhausted. I can't take time for my personal devotional life with the Lord. My prayer life's suffering. My witness with him is suffering. My physical status is drained down. There's no margin in my life. And therefore, you know, I got to pull back somewhere. Listen, it's not the most evil things that Satan does in the lives of most believers. It's the good things that he props up as that. And yet they take you away from the best things. Satan sells us in the big lies that you can handle it and everybody's doing it and it won't happen to you. It's just temporary. Oh, my friend, remember, beware of anything that causes you to lay up treasures and trophies on earth at the expense of eternal treasures and trophies. There's the urgent and there's the important. The important is eternal and the urgent is temporary. Matthew 6:19-21, lay not up treasures on earth where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. Listen, you lay these treasures up on earth, they can all be taken away in a moment, right? And we get to say, no, you don't understand. I've got security systems in place. And I've got a dog in place. You know, and I've got old trusty in place. You know, and you're going to do all you can to reserve these little earthly treasures and trophies. They're all one day going to be taken away. You're going to be leaving them for somebody, right? It's going to come up. And I just looked out the other day and it was really concerning because I looked out, I have a pile of wood. Probably enough to burn next winter. If I die before next winter, someone go to my house, take all that wood, and you burn it somewhere else, all right? I can see my wife remarrying before next winter, and that dude burning my wood, you know what I'm saying? He might have been half the reason I'm in the grave early, you know? I'm sorry, Matthew 6:20, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Oh, my friend, I think about what greater treasure than those eternal things that can't be taken away. 2 Corinthians 4:18, while we look not at things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Satan comes as an angel of light, as a Christian, even in many ministries, pulpits, overseeing ministries. And as a Christian, we need to resist him. How do we resist him? Verse number 9 says, resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. How do you resist him? Two thoughts there. Resist him in your faith. And resist him in the faith. Resist him in your faith, your personal faith, your testimony that you are blood bought by the Lamb of God, Revelation 12:11. I am under the blood, and my testimony is that I am in Jesus Christ, and I rest in that testimony. That's why it's important that you know I am saved. And you go through the discipleship class, and you're confident, you have security, and you have assurance in that, and you stand, I am in the Lord, and I rest in my faith, and I resist you. I'm a child of the King. But also, you rest in the faith. What is this? Remember back in our study, Jude 3 and 4, Jude verse 3 and verse 4, earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered, that which has been like a baton passed down to you, the faith of Christ, the doctrine of Christianity that has been passed down. You know the faith and you stand in those great monumental truths of the faith. Also, never try to fight Satan in your own way. Resist him the way Jesus did with the Word of God, Matthew 4, 1 to 11. We see also, I want you to notice something in these verses, 1 Peter 5, verse number 10. It says, but the God of all grace, who hath called us in his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. I want you to see the personal God. How are you going to be able to endure whatever may come? Remember that God, the God that we serve, the God that we know, it is a personal God. You know, sometimes we think, he just got up there and he has no concern. There's no fingerprints of God in my own life. And yet we see something in these verses. I see it in verse number 5. He says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Verse 7, again, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Verse 10, it says there, after that ye have suffered a while, that he, God, make you perfect. Listen, God is able to see you, know you, care for you, and it says that he, you personally, that God himself is able to intervene and help you when you're humble and exalt you up, and he cares for you. It's a personal thing. And when he sees you suffering for a time, verse number 10, then he's able, after you suffered a while, to then make you perfect. God is interested and involved in your personal walk in life. God's not like this big wholesale factory, right? We're all just a big number and there's no personal intimacy there. No, no. No, God knows you. God cares for you. God is watching you grow as a parent would with a child, as a farmer would with their livestock, right? He's looking down and he cares, and it's a personal relationship. He's a personal God. A God that we have, that he's given us a living hope. 6, see the personal God himself. Number 7 is sanctification there in verse number 10. Sanctification. Notice here that he is sanctifying you, he's consecrating you, but the God of all grace who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you've suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. God will not only begin, continue, and complete the work of sanctification. What is this? The moment you got saved, God's molding you to Jesus Christ, isn't he? He's shaping you and making you into the image, and he will perform that which he started in your life. We see in verse number 10, after you suffered a while, you know that God allows you to suffer? Why would God do that? Why would God allow you to suffer? God molds us, doesn't he? We know that he uses the Spirit of God, he uses the Scriptures, he uses the ministry of the local church to grow you, shape you, mold you, and make you, but he also uses suffering, because it's in the suffering that we are refined, where the chaff falls away and is burned up. That which doesn't reflect him fades away. We've told the story, right? How would the refiner know when the metal was finished? How would he know when the silver and the gold was ready to be taken out of the smelting furnace, when he could look down into the gold or silver and see his reflection there? Can I say to you, God's going to leave us in the furnace long enough to burn everything away that doesn't reflect him. Why? Because as we see in these verses, God's glory is our highest aim. It's not about you or I. It's not about our ease. It's about his glory in our lives. And his glory comes about when I don't look like me, but I look like him. And that's not an easy process, is it? There's no cheap way to sanctification. It will come by the Spirit of God, the Scriptures, the ministry of the church, and through suffering, God leaves us there. But as we said before, God keeps one hand on the thermostat and one hand on the timer. He's going to leave you there long enough to purify you, but He's not going to leave you there one moment too long. So what we need to do is just rest. Lord, I know You're working in me, and You're going to strip everything away that doesn't look like Jesus. So what does Jesus look like? What does God look like? He looks like Jesus. What does Jesus look like? He looks like God. What's God trying to do? He's trying to make you look like Jesus. And right now, a whole lot of us sometimes don't look like Jesus. So until you live your life and say, well, I'm like Jesus every day, well, then he's done with you, right? And probably at that point, He's ready to take you home. You know, He's got you good and ready, right? But in the meantime, listen, He's stripping things away. And there's days I'm like, yeah, well, I feel a lot like Jesus. And there's other days I'm like, who's Jesus? You know what I'm saying? I don't always reflect Him like I should. In Job 23:10, He's refined us. And Job said that I might come forth as gold. Oh, my friend, let's remember something in verse number 10 here. The God of all grace who called us into His eternal glory by Christ Jesus. Notice there, after that ye have suffered a while. Listen, you hear these kind of these shenanigans and these shysters and these swindlers and false preachers and false prophets telling you God wants you to be healthy, wealthy, and prosperous. You ought to just say, shut your mouth. You are not preaching the Word of God. Because my pastor for 34 sermons in a row now has been telling us about faith in the fire and suffering for Jesus. You say, well, what do we see that? Peter's telling them. I'd hate to be in one of those churches and do a verse-by-verse study through 1 Peter. Well, you don't do those kind of verse-by-verse study. You got your name it, claim it verses. You pick and choose and you take those out. You don't talk about suffering because that isn't anything anybody wants to hear about. Those churches are filled with lost people. I hope you understand that. Because the reality is you are baiting people in on the carnal, fleshly nature of man. Who doesn't want to be healthy, wealthy, and prosperous? Have you just not read 1 Peter with me? God will allow me to be suffered, to suffer through this life. Why? What's the point? It's not in the suffering that God revels. It's in the outcome of the suffering. God gets more glory when I look more like Him, and there's no easy way or cheap way to do that. So verse number 10 says, after you suffered, He's going to leave me in the furnace long enough to take everything away that doesn't look like Him. And He's going to strip it away. So I would just admonish you in this. I don't want to lie to you. You're walking with Jesus, your future will have suffering. And you'll come sometimes and you'll say, Pastor, well, what is God doing? Hey, we gave 34 sermons about this. Don't you remember it? Has God left us? No, He hasn't left us. He might be doing His greatest work at times like this. We just need to see a biblical understanding of what He's actually doing. So when those times come and I don't know what God's doing, I can look to the verses and say, yes, hallelujah, God, I'm not there yet, but You're making me more like Jesus. And You got to strip everything away from me. No, I don't want it. I'm not going to invite it. But hallelujah, glory be to Your name if I look like Jesus at the end of my life. So that I can what? Be perfect, established, strengthened, and settled. What are these words? Perfect, mature, and complete. Mature, able to stand complete in Him. Established, confirmed, strengthened. You know, you go through those trials, the Lord, you think it's making you weaker. No, it's really not. It's strengthening you to face more, and then finally, to settle you. You know what that word settle means? To lay a foundation. He's laying a foundation in you. Verse 11 to 14, and I'll be done. The result here is to Him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Verse 12, by Silvanus, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose, I've written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein you stand. You know, the only way we're standing tonight is in the grace of God. I don't stand in my righteousness, nor do you. You stand in the grace of God that saved you and the grace of God that is sustaining you. Verse 13, notice there may come a point in time where we need to say this. The church that is at Babylon. You know, most theologians don't think the church was in Babylon. Babylon was a synonym for Rome. And to protect the believers in Rome, there was an air of hiding in a sense. not to draw any unnecessary attention, that if someone gathered the letter, read the letter, they didn't want to draw any unnecessary attention to themselves. Can you imagine there come a day and time where we have to kind of, in a sense, go underground? So that would never come. I don't know. There's places around our world that that's the case. Elected together with you, saluteth you, and so doth Marcus, my son. Greet ye one another with a kiss of charity. Now, before we begin kissing, I would have you to know that this was a custom in that day and time, and the men kissed the men on the cheek. That'd be whole sorts of awkward otherwise. And the women kissed the women on the cheek. So don't go out here kissing the ladies and kissing the men, right? That was something they did in that time, all right? But we see that. And it says, he closes out. It says, peace be with all of you that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. You know, Peter opened and closed his letter the same way, with the grace and then here with the peace. We saw the grace in the former verse there, verse number 10. We see the peace here. Listen, my friend, I say to you, the world may shake, the world may rock and reel, but if you're staying in the grace of God, you have the peace of God in your life. Would you stand with me tonight? We don't know what's coming, but we know God's already got it in his hand. And tonight, if God has spoken to your heart, if you need to come and you need to be saved, tonight's the night. Maybe tonight you're here and you're facing some hardships and trials and difficulties. I want to invite you to come. If you're not saved, would you come? If you need to be saved, come. If you need to take a next step of baptism or church membership or a closer walk with the Lord or turning away from sin or getting in God's word so you can stand and resist the enemy. Whatever it is, my friend, would you come? Help us to be a ready and essential servant for the Lord. Dear Lord, bless this invitation time. Have your will and way in every life. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you come tonight as we have a time here of invitation? Maybe you want to come and pray for something in your life. Maybe you want to pray for Tim Lee coming in next week, that God would use that as an opportunity to be a witness. And maybe you know someone that you want to pray for that would come and be saved. Would you come tonight as we sing?
Come just as you.
Give these time to pray tonight. If you need to come for any reason, I encourage you, whether you come to the altar or not, but to go out this week and to be a witness and to share Christ and invite someone for next Sunday. I really believe that you will not regret it, and folks would come and hear a clear presentation of the gospel. You may be seated tonight. We finished it. I didn't know if I would, but I was like, we got to do it because Tim Lee's coming in next week, and I can't skip this for two more weeks, you know. Let me have the ushers come tonight, allow you to get back a portion of that which God has entrusted to you. You know, I left a lot of stuff out, so I'm going to have part two here after we do the closing prayer. No, but I do thank the Lord for a great week of revival. Looking forward to just continuing that and be in prayer for next Sunday. Evangelist Tim Lee with us be all week and take some flyers. There's still got a handful out there. Got some more coming in here in a couple days. Help us get the word out. Maybe you know some people in some of the different veteran facilities around and some of the homes that are there. We'd love to have them come, and they'd be our welcome guests next Sunday. As well. Wednesday night ministry at 6:30. Next Saturday morning, men's prayer breakfast at 9. Full breakfast, and then outreach and visitation at 10. In the month of May, several special things with fellowships. The ladies' conference, I should say, Beauty for Ashes, is Saturday, May the 15th. Please sign up for that as well. So a lot of things. Please get a bulletin. Keep up to date with everything going on. If you're visiting with us tonight, take a moment to fill out the visitor card. Let's ask God's blessing here. On the offering. And Ken Arnold, would you pray for us? First sermons in that series, we talked about a living hope. We have a confident expectation of our eternal salvation. The world has a hope that dies. We have a hope that lives. No matter what the world ever does to us, no matter how bad they treat us, they can't take away our living hope of confident salvation in Jesus Christ. We rest tonight in that, amen. And so we always, no matter what, we win, right? We win-win. It's a win-win for us. And so let's close out with a word of prayer. For anyone who would like to, just nothing really official, but some folks going back to play volleyball, if you're welcome to hang around. And Josh Carl's got 6 months pent up of volleyball in him. And so he never comes on Sunday nights, but he heard volleyball, so he said, no. But he's going to be out there. So we're going to go out and play some volleyball for anybody who wants to. Otherwise, just hang around and or not, and we'll see you there on Wednesday night. Will Hickey, would you pray for us tonight?